proud of me.
Oh. Okay. All right. Hey, just a reminder. No cell phones. If I see a cell phone today, I'm taking it. I'm forewarned. Put them away. Okay, so I'm in no mood for cell phones today. I'm ready to deal with this plenty of times today. So, alright. Okay, chapter 8. We're going to do a few notes today. I'm going to cover what we talked about in class yesterday. So if you're gone, we're going to talk about it. Goal today is to actually just get through notes. We're probably not going to get to homework today. I thought we were. Yeah, we're not going to get there. I just know the notes we have. We're not going to get there. So we'll save the 5 times we're going to get for homework. Okay. Alright, question.
Okay, so I have a question to ask you, and it's totally untriangle.
Then ask me later. So, alright. So, 8-1, here we go. Goals today, just so you know. We're going to talk about the AA postulate. That was the postulate that the sub, whoever he or she was, put on the board yesterday. We need to make sure that we cover that. Okay, I want to make sure that you understand what it means. We talked about it a little bit on Wednesday, but it could have easily forgot by it. So I want to make sure we cover that. That postulate's weird, because it's found actually in chapter 7. I know that's why it's one of the chapters we skipped, but there's one thing we actually needed. It basically talks about similarity. Similarity is when you compare two pictures, they're the same picture, it's just one's bigger versus the other. They're like scaled versions of each other. It's like a model car versus the real car. They look identical, one's bigger, one's smaller. Okay? And again, the reason why is because of proportion. The big thing today is, can you solve a proportion correctly? Can you get the right answer? Do you know what it means? Okay. The next vocab term we're going to talk about is how to apply that to a right triangle where we have two vocab words, legs and hypotenuses. We're going to talk about that today. Hopefully the sub had that from the notes yesterday. And then the last thing we're going to talk about today is radicals and how to use them. This is a topic we have definitely discussed in this classroom before, the first semester, but it's been a long time we need to introduce it again. Radicals are a big topic for Algebra 2 and pre-calc, so it's one of those things I like to build you up, and so that when you get there, you feel a little more comfortable. You know what they are, what they mean, how to solve them, that type of thing. And again, there's a couple of vocab words that come with radicals, so we'll talk about that. All right, any questions with kind of the rough outline of what we're talking about today? Question?
How was basketball yesterday?
It was awesome. Moving on. All right. Okay. All right, postulate 7.1. AA postulate, it's called angle-angle similarity, right? That's the term. If two angles of one triangle are congruent to two angles of another triangle, then the triangles are what they call, quote-unquote, similar. Not equal, but similar. So here's the picture that we kind of used. Kind of weird. What's up with this spacing here? Oh. Yeah, we'll go with that. That'll work. Okay. All right.
What? I was stretching, and then all of a sudden I got knuckles.
Okay. All right. So, two angles of one triangle match, two angles of another. Now, why this pertains to the word similar, like similarity, is because when you have two angles that match, it actually forces the triangles to actually be in proportion with each other. That's actually the definition of similarity, that pictures are almost identical to each other. They're just scaled. So how that works, it's kind of like when you take a cell phone and you do that pinch and zoom, where you look at a picture and you look in versus out and you zoom in and out on it. It's actually doing a similarity property. It's the same picture. The angles in the corners aren't changing, just the wall lengths are, or whatever the figure is, whatever the dimensions of your polygon that you're looking at. Okay, so like, for instance, if you know, this is the same picture, all I did was like, maybe I zoomed out, or zoomed in a little bit on this, or zoomed out, depending on which direction you go, there is some number that it's scaled. So maybe, like, maybe this wall cut in half to get to this one. That would be the same proportion for all the rest of them. That the proportion would actually hold up. And it doesn't have to be half, it could be, you know, by decimals, but there's some weird scale that would make the other picture. The weird thing that people don't understand, when you zoom and pinch on a picture, the angles in the corners don't change, whatever that polygon is, whatever the shape you're looking at. Just the wall lengths do. So it's actually the same picture, which is, it really weirds people out, and it's because of this. Okay? And that's called a similar object. Now, we have a notation for that, like an actual symbol. We use this little tilde symbol, it's a little squiggle. We're going to use that from now on. So I'll kind of show you that as we go through problems, like how that little symbol works, but I want to make sure that you understand how that's going to apply to our problems today. Okay? Now, proportions. This is one of the things that's like a general math topic that I want to make sure everyone in this room knows how to solve it, usually by my method. And I think we talked about this on Wednesday. Proportions, by definition, is we compare two ratios, two fractions, using the equality symbol, right? So it's means versus extremes. That's one of the vocab terms we're going to talk about, like how that applies to my picture. But for the fraction, this is it. I can zoom in on that. Zoom, all right. Okay. On this fraction, typically I'm like in a general math course, one of the numbers is missing. One, right? So, you know, if I put some numbers in here, I'll say this is 20, and I get 100 over here, and this is a 35, right? We can solve that proportion. Now, there's two methods of solving it, okay? You can solve it by cross product, which I call, quote unquote, I think I call it fish method on Wednesday. How that works, you start above or below the x, you cross multiply, and then you divide by the remaining number, and it gives you x, and it looks like a little goldfish. So it's called a cross product, that's the real name, but you start with the 20, the number above or below x, you cross multiply on the 35, and you divide by 100, and eventually we get 7. Okay? Now, why? Why would that work? Why would a cross product eventually get there? It's an algebra 1 problem. Right, we know that the fractions are equal, so you can get common denominators and actually figure out what they went by. Here's another method of solving. Some people, like, they know proportions, like that's how you're taught in elementary, but there's another way to do this problem. You can do it by a scalar multiplier. What I mean by that is you figure out what did you multiply on 20 to make 100? Well, they multiplied to 5. So that was the same thing that happened up here. They took this x times 5, to make the 35. It's the same number that you multiply by. So the only way that that could work is if x is a 7. 7 times 5 is 35. That's the idea. So that's one way to solve it. Or maybe you went the other way. You divide by 5, divide by 5. Now, does that work every time? No. That's why I actually prefer a proportion. Okay, because what if this number was 30? Now it doesn't work anymore. Now you're going to get some weird decimal. Because I can't think of a number off the top of my head that I can multiply on 30 to make 100. It'd be like a decimal. So you'd actually have to take, I would actually cross multiply and divide. So 30 times 35, and again, you know, that's over 100, because I'm going to divide by the 100. 30 times 35, that's 0, 5, carry once. And 100, and you divide by 100, and you get 10.5. So, questions with how to solve that, and again, that would be my x number. Again, all I did was start a number above or below the x, cross multiply, divide, it looks like a goldfish. Alright, moving on. Alright, now, let's talk about the vocab words that I have written on the board. It's called means versus extremes. The goal of today, if you actually look at the title of this section, our goal is to talk about what a mean is. Like a geometric mean for a picture. So that's what I want to discuss. I want to talk about how to find that number. And that especially applies to proportions, not just always cross multiply. But what happens when I'm missing two numbers in that fraction? Could I still solve it? And the answer to that problem is yes, you can actually still solve it if two numbers are missing, but they have to be in very specific spots. And that's what I want to talk about. Now, before we can move on to that, we have to discuss these vocab words. So the first word is called a mean, right? That was the main word that we need to discuss. That's the title of the section, right? Well, here's how it works, okay? Means versus extremes. I'm going to change these fractions to be in what they call a quote-unquote colon method, okay? Colon method is where you write ratios instead of as fractions. You write them with a little colon method, so it's written like this. You know, A over B is the same thing as A colon B. It's how a digital clock works, like in your bedroom. Oh. Right? They have an hour colon a number. It's a ratio. It's a fraction. And the second number of C colon D. Okay, so this is the way I can set two ratios equal to each other. Okay, now the word means, the word mean here is the middle numbers. In algebra class, when they talk about means, or it's like an average, it's the middle numbers. These are the means on this problem. This is what we're actually looking for today. That's kind of the goal of this section. The extremes, so again, the means are B and C. The extremes are the outsides, like the extreme ends of the problem are A and D. They're the outsides. These are the extremes. Typically on a problem, we're given the extremes. We need to find the means, the numbers in the middle. So again, A and D are the extreme ends of the problem. Okay, any questions with what we're going to be doing here? The goal is to find the part in the box. And how we do that, we solve it using a proportion.
What do you use that for?
Solving proportions. Solving fractions.
Like for what?
For a geometric problem. When one number is missing, but you can set up a proportion for it, you can solve it. I'll show you, I'll do a kind of an example in this classroom how we can do it. How we can use it anyway. Okay, we good?
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on. Let's talk about what we're going to go into, and we'll come back to this topic. This topic's not going to go away. So on the next part here, let's talk about the actual triangle itself. A right triangle, that's the main part of this chapter, chapter 8. It's only right triangles. Okay, the definition of that word is where it's a triangle of any type, but it contains a right angle. One right angle. Now, the picture of that, this is what we've been using up to this point. One of the angles has to be a right. So I use letter D here. So the other two angles, we call these the acute angles. Now why they have to be acute is because we've had properties leading up to this point. The part that I want you to know is the vocab terms that I'm going to use today, and then we're going to apply it to the proportion stuff. So when I look at a right triangle, the two walls that touch this right angle, there's one right angle, these are called the legs. Now, the bad news is, we've had the word leg before. We've talked about isosceles triangles, right? Isosceles triangles are where the legs are the same, okay? On a right triangle, they don't have to be. As you can tell from my picture, like one of the walls is short, one of them is medium, okay? The short wall on that one is the vertical one, CD. That leg is definitely short. The medium length wall is AD. The biggest wall has a name. Anyone know what the name is called? Yeah, it's the hypotenuse. We've actually talked about that before. It was in the middle of chapter 4 when we talked about what the hypotenuse is. Hypotenuse is always the biggest wall of a right triangle. How I always remember it, it's across from 90 degrees. Like straight across from it. Like you can't miss it. Unless you're blind, there should be no reason why you don't know which one's the hypotenuse. Okay, it's just common sense, it's the biggest wall. The other two have to be shorter. Now, the reason being, is that because the angles are small. In fact, the properties we've had up to this point actually explain why the legs don't have to be the same, how they could be different. So the properties we've had in chapter 4, like previously, one of the corollaries we had was 4-1, the acute angles are complementary. So the acute angles are the smaller angles, it's these two. These two angles have to add up to be 90. They're small, but they have to add up to be 90. So doesn't matter what number. So somebody give me a random number.
45.
Okay? If that's 45, the other one has to be 45. Because they have to add to be 90. Now, if I pick 40, right, that's 40, then the other one's 50. Like they're just smaller. They're smaller than 90, but they have to add to make 90. And the reason being is that triangles have to add to be 180. And the only way this adds up to be 180 is if that's 90 plus 90. So that's the reason why. But if the numbers are different, like in this case, the walls are different lengths. So they don't have to be the same. Now, the other property we had is that in any triangle, there can be only at most one right angle. One right or one obtuse. Well, I already have a right, so none of the rest of them are right, or none of the rest of them are obtuse. So these have to be acute. So these go hand in hand. I believe what we call these corollaries, I think it was called 4.10 part 1 and part 2, because these corollaries followed the theorem 4.10. Okay, questions on the vocab terms I'm going to use. If you don't know these words, these next couple properties we're going to look at, like, we have one more slide then we're going to get to the properties today. You will not know what they're talking about. We have to know which ones are the legs, which ones are hypotenuse. Okay, all right, let's move on to the next one. So what we need to talk about before we get to the actual three properties, because we are going to talk about three. We're going to talk about radicals. Okay, radicals is a type of root that we're going to do in our class. We're going to do it in Algebra 2. We'll do it in pre-calc quite a bit. There's different types of roots. There's square roots, there's cube roots, and et cetera, like fourth roots and fifth roots and all that. What most people have a problem with is that they don't even know what they are. You don't know how to solve it. Most people rely on a calculator. But most people don't even know what they look like. This is it. This is a root. In fact, that one's a square root. This number on the inside can be any type of number that you want. Okay, that's the part that you need to know. Okay, my goal today, before we move on to the next slide, we get to these properties, I want you to know the basics about this object. You know, either A, number one, how to type in a calculator, and number two, how to do it by hand. So you don't need a calculator. In fact, people that can do this by hand are infinitely better at radicals than somebody that knows how to type in a calculator. The reason being is that you're not overthinking the problem. When you type in a calculator, you'll overthink the problem. When you do it by hand, you actually break it down to what it actually is telling you. Okay? So this first type is actually a square root. Now the goal is to talk about why. Why do they call this a square root, not another type of root? And what are the other vocab terms? So that's what we're going to talk about first, vocabulary terms with this picture. Okay? Alright. So first of all, we have a radical sign. That's the actual symbol itself. There's different types of radicals that we have, but this is just the radical sign itself. The second part is called a radicand. That is the number on the inside. That's the x in this case. So that's the radicand number. It could be any number we want. It could even be variables in Algebra 1 class. How many people have actually seen this in Algebra class? Just a handful? Okay, so a handful have actually, or at least remember it enough to say that they've seen it. The second one is called an index number. Most algebra kids will never see that word before, index number. If you did, you're lucky. We need to talk about this. This is going to be one of our major parts today, knowing what an index number is. Then, the main thing is, do we know how they all fit together? So I'm going to get rid of this picture, and you're driving me nuts right now. All right, so cube root here, okay? So we have a number on the inside called the radicand. We have the index number on the outside. We have the radical sign itself. This radical here is called a cube root. Cube root because it has a 3 for an index number. The index number is the number inside the tail. Most people never see that because in Algebra 1, you'd only see one type of radical. You'd see a square root like that. They could put any number on the inside. They could put like 121 in here, but they'll never put the number here. Because the index number is actually secretly a 2. Okay, if it's a 2, that's a square root. And typically in algebra, and algebra 2 and pre-calc, if it has a power of 2 for the index number, they won't put that in there. They'll just leave it blank. It's the one time in math we assume it's a 2. Now, in like Microsoft Word, I don't know why, if you ever have to type in a square root in Microsoft Word, they put the index number really tall but really small. So, like, if it's a square root, they won't type it in there. But if it is there, it would be a really small 2 like that, which I'm always weirded out by it because it should be closer to the actual tail. Now, the index number actually tells you what you're doing. And that's the part that, like, if you don't understand what a radical is, like what this is saying, it's because you don't know what this number means. That's the problem. And that's what I want to explain to you, how to do this by hand. Because if you know how to do it by hand, then it makes way more sense. Okay, so let's start with the square root here. Okay, what this is saying, since I have an index number of 2, okay, even though they wouldn't print it, what that's saying is that you're trying to take a number times itself to get the 121. Okay, reason being, you're looking for two numbers multiplied together. two numbers multiplied together. So 1 over 2, if you take times itself, you get 121.
11.
Okay. 11 times 11 would give you 121. Or, negative 11. Because the negative signs would cancel. So you'd still get 121. I only want one of them. The one number I want is the actual positive number. This one. That one actually has a name. It is called the principal square root. That's something you need to know. I want the principal square root. Now, the reason why I want the positive. Because what we're going to be doing is finding the length of a wall of a right triangle. You know, a missing piece. Do negative numbers make sense for walls?
No.
No. Because
you can't go backwards.
Yeah. Negative distance doesn't make sense. It's like if you ever used a Fitbit or an Apple Watch for a pedometer, figuring out how many steps you take in a day. It doesn't make sense if I move forward and backwards. It tells me I took negative 10 steps. It doesn't make any sense. I moved. That's so many steps I just took to do that. So they're only going to give you positive numbers. So that's called a principal square root. Okay? That applies to square roots, which is this type, when they have power 2 on it. So I want the positive.
What's power of 3?
Power 3. Okay? They don't worry about principles. Okay? Because on a cube root, there's only one answer, not two. Because on a cube root, you're trying to think of a number that you take times itself 3 times to make the number on the inside. Well, now you don't have to worry about positive negatives. It can only be one answer because you're multiplying it 3 times. So whatever you did, you take times itself 3 times to make 8?
2.
2 times 2 times 2. And that actually gives you 8 because 2 times 2 is 4, and you take it times 2 again, which is 8. That's the answer. In fact, the answer for cube root of 8 is 2. That's what it would tell you on a calculator if you know how to type that in. That makes way more sense if you know how to do it by hand, because you actually understand what the symbol means. Now, where does it come from? Like, why do they have a square root? Where does this come in math? It comes from when you try to solve a problem like x squared equals 121. Because how you solve algebra problems, especially when they have powers, you do the inverse operation to the other side. So if I want to get the x by itself, I'm going to take the opposite operation of the power of 2. The power of 2 is called a square. That's what we call it, right? X squared. Well, the inverse operation of a square is a square root. That's why they call it a square root. So you are taking the square root of 121, which is 11. That's the idea. That's where this comes up. That's what we're going to be doing. We're going to be solving for a missing wall. Sometimes the problems turn out to be square roots, and you need to know how to go further. Now, here's the problem. What happens if it's not a nice number? Like, I've given you very nice numbers, like 121 or 8 when I take the cube root. Those have very nice, easy numbers. What happens when I'm trying to take the square root of a goofy number like square root of 12? Now it's goofy. That number doesn't make any sense anymore. So, because if you're trying to think about it, okay, 3 times 3 is 9, 4 times 4 is 16. I'm in between there. It's a decimal between 3 and 4. I don't want the decimal. Because, in fact, if you type that in a calculator, your calculator actually gets it wrong. Because your calculator actually approximates what it is. It's called a decimal approximation. It's not even the right number.
Wow.
So, if you want to do it by hand, here's how I'm going to teach it. And I teach this by, this is the method that Mr. Godden uses. So if you've had Mr. Godden before, this is the method he teaches for doing the squares, and I like it. It's really easy to remember. You can do it for any type of radical. You break down 12 into numbers that multiply to give me 12. So think of any two numbers that multiply to give me 12.
3. 6.
All right, so 6. Let's do 6 and 2. Okay? If you're that 3 and 4 person, do 3 and 4. Okay? Now what we do is now you're breaking this up, you know, these two numbers that multiply give me 12. Let's break up the 6 even further, because 6 can be broken up.
3 and 2.
Okay. So 3 and 2 and the other 2. So I broke up the 6 even further. So these are all the numbers. If I were to multiply these all together, it would give me 12. Notice I didn't go to 1s. 1s are stupid. I don't use them. Okay? All right. So I broke up the number as far as I can. So what type of index number do I have? What's my index number outside?
Two.
Okay. What that means is I'm looking for a pair of numbers, two numbers that match. Two. Is there numbers in here that match?
Two.
Yes, two. They just happen to be twos, but it could be any number. It could be like 7 and 7. But as long as you have a pair, two numbers that match, this is how Mr. Scott teaches it. He says, cross one of them out and kick the other one outside the house. Just kick it out. Now, when you do that, what are you left with? Well, the two's on the outside. You're left with the radical sign and whatever's left on the inside. This is the exact answer. On like a math placement test in college. So that's an ACT, a MAPS test, an ITBS or ITEDS test. Yes, math, ITBS, and ITEDS are actually college entrance exam tests. Don't know that. They're actually on your transcripts. Colleges actually look at your scores to see if they should accept you or not. A lot of people don't know that. Okay, that is the answer that I look at. Because I'm thinking back to like when I was going into Iowa State, I had to take a math placement test. Like, where am I sitting in with my math? They don't allow you to use calculators on that test. They don't. They say not to use them. Same with the math test. You can't use a calculator. So you had to know what your answer is, like the exact answers without decimals. That's how I do it. That would be one of the options, A, B, C, or D. Do you see how easy it is though? You're looking for pairs. Now, if we're doing a triple, like a cube root, you're looking for triples, numbers that match three times. You circle, kick, cross two of them out, kick one out. Because one always goes to the outside, the others disappear. But that's how Mr. Gowan teaches it. I like it. It's super easy to remember how to do that. And if they don't have any pairs, you don't have to do anything. And it's done. You can't do anything. Okay, now. Why do we do this? Because I did a complete 180, right? We talked about proportions, and then suddenly I started talking about this crazy stuff. We're going to put them together now. Okay. Can we do a math problem, like a geometry problem, where you have to solve a proportion, but they contain square roots? Okay? All right, so let's get to our first property here. First property of the day.
18.
Oh, yeah. All right. So, first property, I'll let you write this down. So this is theorem 8.1. It's our first theorem of the day. It does not have a name. Here you go. I'll let you write it down. Then we'll talk about, I'll give you the picture. I'll discuss what we're going to use it for. So here's what it says. The altitude in a right triangle is drawn to the hypotenuse. So you got to know what the hypotenuse is. Then it forms two different triangles. Those triangles are actually similar to the original and to each other. And I'll explain. So let you write that down. Yeah, I could see it blinking from up here. All right, so altitude is drawn to the hypotenuse of a right triangle. So let me draw the right triangle. So here's the big triangle itself. Where's my quadrat? There it is. So here's your big triangle, and I'm going to draw an altitude to the other side. So this is your big triangle here. Okay, so it's got a right angle in it. So I'm going to flip it over, right? So this is the big triangle, and I'm going to draw an altitude towards the hypotenuse. This was the hypotenuse of the big triangle. That's the hypotenuse, right? It's the big wall of that where the right angle is. So I drew the altitudes go straight down, they form right angles. So what should happen, if you can see this, it formed two different triangles. There's one triangle, and here's the other. Do you see that there's two of them? Okay, and in fact, that's what I have down here. So I have the two different smaller triangles, and then you can see the letters that they use. So I kind of separate them using color. Remember, the big triangle is this one, it's the ABC triangle. So that's supposed to be a right triangle. Okay, the big one is. They're actually all related to each other. There's some weird proportion that scales from the big triangle to this one, and then another proportion that scales to the smaller one. Now, how do I know that? How do I know that all three of those triangles are actually related to each other? Because of the postulate we did earlier, that when two angles are shared, pictures are actually proportional. There is two angles in each of these triangles that actually explain why they're actually all related to each other. Because would you agree that, you know, this triangle, and the big triangle all have right angles in them? That's one. Now, when you compare this triangle over here, that's this triangle right here. This is ABC, right? ADC. That triangle has angle A in it, right?
Yeah.
So does the big one. It has angle A. So that means they share two angles. They have angle A and the right angle. Angle A and the right angle. So they're actually scaled versions of each other. So there's some weird number I can multiply, I cut it in half, and it makes these walls. And this smaller triangle, which is this little tiny guy, is related to the big one and this one because it also shares two angles.
The right angle.
The right angle.
And then C.
Angle B. Angle B. And that's how it's scaled version of the bigger one. And the bigger one is the scaled version of A, B, C. So that's how they work. And again, what similar means, they're proportional to each other. The two triangles. So there is some weird fraction I could write for these. And you're probably wondering, okay, fine. I see if they're related, but why? What are we going to do it for? How can we use it? That's what the next theorem is all about. Can I use this concept to find a wall? That's what we're going to do. So here's 8.2. This one actually has a name. It's called the geometric mean. And we're going to be talking about the altitude. And I'll use an example in this room how we could use it. Okay? All right, so here it is. The altitude is drawn towards the hypotenuse of a right triangle. It separates the hypotenuse into two parts, like the last picture I just did, right? So I'm going to draw a bigger version. So this is the bigger version of ABC, of the big right triangle. I drew the altitude straight down towards the hypotenuse. It's the hypotenuse. You see that I broke the hypotenuse into two smaller parts.
Yep.
Yeah, there's the two triangles. The small triangle, the bigger triangle. Right? And then the real big one. What they're saying here is that the altitude is actually related to the two parts of the hypotenuse, x and y. So this altitude, which is letter h, is the height of a triangle, is actually related to these two pieces. How I'd use it for this room is, imagine that this is the marker board. So this is the front of the room. I should spell front, right? That's the front of the room. This is the back of the room. This is the projector up in the air. That's the projector up there, right? I can actually figure out how high it is in the air by knowing the number of steps. So if I start at the front of the room and walk so that I'm straight below the projector. So here I am, 1, 2, 3-ish. So it's about, I don't know, 9, 10 feet. Steps are about 3 feet apiece. So let's say it's 9 feet, right? Say that's 9 feet, roughly, right? And now I do the same thing. I start at the projector and I walk to the back of the room. Right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, maybe 8. 8 steps to the back of the room, so maybe 24 feet. I can roughly figure out how tall the projector is up there. Is it going to be accurate? Eh, maybe not. But the concept is there. I can figure out the actual geometric mean. What that number roughly is, how high it's actually bolted to the ceiling. Now, am I going to be accurate? No, I made up those numbers. Because I have no idea if I'm stepping 3 feet. But I can get the answer. How I know this, what this is actually saying, these words, these fancy way of saying it, I can set up proportions to do this. Okay? Because, here's what I want you to look at. I want you to look at this smaller triangle over here. Yes, this is a small triangle. It's a right triangle. Okay? What is the smallest wall of this triangle? That's AD, right? That's the smallest wall. I'm going to put that over the medium wall. The medium wall is the H, going up and down. And do you agree? This is the small wall, that's the medium wall. This would be the biggest wall of that triangle. That'd be the hypotenuse of that right triangle. Okay? Let's compare that to this triangle over here. What is the smallest wall of this triangle?
H.
That's the small wall of that triangle. What's the medium wall in this triangle?
Y.
That's a proportion. These words allow me to write it because they say that my triangles are similar to each other. That I can actually find there's a geometric mean here. That there's a number, there's a relationship between these. My x, I just said a little bit ago, was 9 feet. My y, I said, was 24 feet. and I can solve for h. Now, you agree that that proportion's goofy. Has two letters. That's weird. We've never done a proportion where it has two letters. We only did one where it had one letter, and we did the fish method. How you do this? It's still called a cross product. It's the correct term, right? Cross product, cross multiply. If you cross multiply and you set them equal to each other, so I multiply the h's together, so that's h squared. H times h is h squared. I multiply these two together. 9 times 24. That's a 6. Carry the 3 over. 9 times 2 is 18 plus 3 is 216. Then I take the square root. So I'm going to take the square root to the other side, because that's the opposite of power 2 of 216. On a calculator, that is just below 15. It's like 14 point something. If I'm typing in the calculator. I know that 225 is 15. 15 times 15 is 225. 14 times 14 is 196. So it's in between 14 and 15. So it's a weird decimal. If you want to do it by Mr. Godin's method, you figure out numbers that multiply to be 216, be 2 and 108. But I keep writing that down. I'd circle pairs, kick them out. But eventually, you know, whatever that is, that'd be the same as this number. So roughly what this is saying, that projector should be roughly bolted about 14 feet above you. Okay, is that 14 feet above you? No, but the actual like base at the very top up in the ceiling, actually it probably is. That's the one way at the top of the ceiling. That'd be like the highest point the projector is actually hanging down from where it's bolted to the roof. So is it somewhat accurate? Yeah, maybe, because I don't know if my steps are correct. I made up those numbers. But it can give me the idea of how to do it. That's what we're going to be going into. My goal for this first section is to walk through these properties. We're going to do a couple more on Monday, obviously. But I'm going to give you a triangle, and we're going to see, can we find a missing wall by using this? Now, obviously, you need to know how to set up the proportion, so I'll teach you that Monday again. And can we simplify the square root? And you do that by hand. We'll practice that more on Monday. Make
sense?
Monday, yeah. You're going to get homework. 5 problems. So I'll give it to you. Or, well, okay, so there you go.
I have a question for you, Mr. Warren.
What do you
have? Do you play solitaire?
I do. Solitaire.
Okay.
Do you
know the base? Yes.
Oh.
So you have to have a
hey, where are you
lower
going?
Number.
Oh, wow. Oh, yeah.
You have to have a lower number, but the opposite color. So if you start with...